Tag TV brings you daily news bulletin from India. Breaking news and views from India.
Good evening. Welcome to South Asia Newsline. I'm Yeshi Chansop. Here are the top stories we are tracking for you on Tuesday, the 1st of December. Indian government holds talks with farmers protesting against new farm laws. Khalid Khurshid elected as chief minister of illegally occupied Gilgit-Baltistan territory. And Nepal's female soldiers break tradition of cremating bodies amid COVID-19 crisis. And now for all the details. India's ministers of Agriculture and Commerce and Industry began formal talks with the leaders of farmer unions on Tuesday, seeking to allay concerns about recently passed farm laws. Meanwhile, protests against the agriculture reform laws, which farmers fear will dismantle the minimum support price system and corporatize farming, entered the sixth day on Tuesday.
India's Agriculture Minister Narendra Singh Tomar and Commerce and Industry Minister Piyush Goyal held talks with leaders of protesting farmers on Tuesday. Seeking to allay concerns about new laws, growers fear could pave the way for the government to stop buying grain at guaranteed prices, leaving them at the mercy of private buyers. Agriculture Minister Tomar before the meeting said the options which the government will offer to farmers will depend on the exact demands which they present. The details of the meeting were, however, not immediately known. Meanwhile, protests against the new farm laws entered sixth day on Tuesday. The agitation intensified since last week when farmers mainly from northern farm belt of Punjab and Haryana states arrived in trucks, buses and tractors at Delhi's Singhu border and have continued to block the main northern highway into the capital.
तो अगर सरकार वो कानून रद्द करती है और एमएसपी को लीगल राइट बनाती है तब हम अपना आंदोलन समाप्त करेंगे नहीं तो हम दिल्ली का घेराव इसी तरह जारी रखेंगे
On Monday, Prime Minister Narendra Modi resisted calls for the repeal of farm reforms, saying growers were being misled and that new laws would benefit them. On Tuesday, more protesters from across the country converged near Delhi borders, prompting the Delhi police to beef up security.
Polling for the 43 constituencies in the second phase of local election for District Development Council in India's Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir was held on Tuesday amid coronavirus pandemic. The contest is between the newly launched People's Alliance for Gupkar Declaration, a political alliance between the multiple political parties, India's ruling BJP and the Apni Party.
The second phase of local elections was held in India's northern Jammu and Kashmir Union Territory on Tuesday amid coronavirus pandemic. Voters queued up at polling stations for the District Development Council elections early in the day in Srinagar, Jammu and Rajouri cities and cast their votes as their temperatures were measured and hands were sanitized on arrival. 43 out of 280 constituencies in the Union Territory are going to polls in DDC elections. These elections are the first being held after the abrogation of Article 370 and the reorganization of erstwhile state of Jammu and Kashmir.
Election is time bahut acche tarike se polling ho rahi hai to hame lagta hai hame isse kuch fayda hoga DDC election se lagta hai hame kafi ye fayda hi hoga kyunki ye pehli baar humne dekha DDC election jahan pehli baar ye ho raha hai isse aage humne aisa kuch nahi dekha.
Regional parties including the National Conference, People's Democratic Party, People's Conference and CPIM formed an alliance and are fighting the maiden DDC elections together. National parties Bharatiya Janata Party and Congress are also in the fray. This comes as India recorded 31,118 new coronavirus cases, the lowest daily tally since November 17. India now has 9.46 million COVID-19 infections and total deaths stands at 137,621.
In news from Pakistan, Asifa Bhutto Zardari, the youngest daughter of Pakistan's slain Prime Minister Benazir Bhutto, made her political debut in Multan on Monday at a rally of opposition alliance, the Pakistan Democratic Movement. In her maiden public address, she hit out at Prime Minister Imran Khan's government and said that people of the country had decided that the selected government should be sent packing. Asifa Bhutto Zardari, youngest daughter of late Pakistan Prime Minister Benazir Bhutto, made her entry into active politics with her maiden public address on Monday, in which she said that people of the country had decided that the selected government should be sent packing. Asifa, while addressing a public meeting of the 11 opposition party alliance Pakistan Democratic Movement's fifth power show in Multan, warned Prime Minister Imran Khan's government that if they arrested workers of the Pakistan People's Party, their sisters would come out to protest and save the country. Asifa attended the rally on behalf of her brother Bilawal Bhutto Zardari, who had earlier tested COVID-19 positive. During the rally, Pakistan Muslim League Nawaz Vice President Maryam Nawaz said that Asifa and herself had come to the rally to fight for the rights of the Pakistanis, even though her grandmother had passed away recently. She also lashed out at Khan's recent statement on opposition allowing the spread of COVID-19 infection, to which she questioned, doesn't it spread in government officials' public meetings? Moving on. Pakistan Tehreek-e-Insaf leader Khalid Khurshid Khan was on Monday elected as the new chief minister of illegally occupied region of Gilgit-Baltistan. Meanwhile, protests by locals and opposition parties have continued against the Pakistan government, blaming it of blatant misuse of power and rigging in the assembly elections held on November 15.
Pakistan Tehreek-e-Insaf or PTI leader Khalid Khurshid Khan was on Monday elected as the new chief minister of illegally occupied region of Gilgit-Baltistan. Khurshid got 22 votes against Pakistan People's Party's Amjad Hussain, who has been selected as the leader of opposition. This comes as Pakistan's Prime Minister Imran Khan's PTI won majority of 23 seats in Gilgit-Baltistan assembly elections held on November 15. Meanwhile, protests have continued across Gilgit-Baltistan by locals and opposition parties against the Pakistan government, blaming the elections in the illegally occupied region were rigged and there were irregularities in the poll process.
Koi judge ke zariye usko khole, insaaf wala judge hoga uske zariye khole, agar wo hum haar gaye to hum apni shikast tasleem karenge kyunki hum samajhte hain ki hamare mandate ko chori kiya hai.
This year's elections were of uncommon importance and desperation for Islamabad, as activists have blamed Pakistan's all-weather friend China wants it to gain complete political control over the illegally occupied region for its strategic and ambitious China-Pakistan economic corridor. Imran Khan in the run-up to the polls had also declared the status of a provisional province to Gilgit-Baltistan, a move against UN resolutions.
In news from Afghanistan, Fawzia Khufi, one of the peace negotiators in Afghan peace talks with the Taliban in Doha, has said the negotiations have entered a new phase. Khufi said she is hoping at this new stage, the militant group will show more flexibility in addressing the demands of the people of Afghanistan.
Afghan peace negotiator Fawzia Khufi has informed the Doha talks have entered a new phase and said that she is hoping at this new stage the Taliban will show more flexibility in addressing the demands of the people of Afghanistan. According to local media reports, a 21-article set of procedural rules was finalized by both the Afghan government and the Taliban in the negotiations. But the presidential palace has said it will not agree on the finalization of the procedural rules until the completion of the formation of High Council for National Reconciliation.
This comes as head of the High Council for National Reconciliation, Abdullah Abdullah, is facing criticism for the delay in making the council fully staffed and functional. In August, President Ashraf Ghani in a decree announced 45 politicians as member of the leadership of the High Council, but the decision was rejected by Abdullah. The European Union, the UK and US embassy in Kabul has also called for urgent establishment and operationalization of the Reconciliation Council as it is delaying the peace process.
Moving on to news from Sri Lanka. Sri Lanka's Justice Minister Ali Sabri has appointed a special 5-member committee to investigate the unrest which erupted in the maximum security prison in Mohara in the outskirts of capital Colombo. The incident on Sunday has left at least 8 inmates dead and over 70 injured. Sabri said the committee will probe into the reasons which led to the clash erupting between prisoners and prison guards and will provide recommendations to prevent such unrest. The unrest broke out when a group of inmates at the Mohara prison tried to escape from the prison as another group of inmates was found to be infected with COVID-19. Police said the inmates were protesting against the spread of COVID-19 virus and wanted to be released from the prison that holds at least 2,500 prisoners. Meanwhile, Sri Lanka's police chief has also directed the Criminal Investigations Department to conduct a separate investigation on the orders of the Defence Secretary. In news from Nepal, Nepal's army is responsible for managing the bodies of coronavirus victims across the nation, and for the first time, female soldiers are also being deployed to help. It's a position once unimaginable in the conservative Hindu-majority country where women touching a dead body is still a cultural taboo.
Female Nepal Army soldiers are being deployed for the first time to manage the bodies of victims of COVID-19, a scenario unimaginable in the conservative Himalayan nation in recent years. The women soldiers are being trained in managing bodies with COVID-19, disposing them off in a sanitized and safe manner and keeping their own safety intact. Women touching a dead body or carrying it for cremation is still a taboo in Nepal. But rights for women have improved since the majority Hindu country emerged from a decade-long conflict in 2006 and abolished its centuries-old feudal monarchy 2 years later.
गर्न पाए अब एउटा हाम्रो एउटा यो जिम्मेवारीको रूपमा अब हामीलाई एक चुनौती नै थियो हैन अब कसरी गर्न सकेला या नसकेला भनि जोस भित्र मनमा उ भइराको थियो तर यसलाई यो चुनौतीले हामीले जिम्मेवारी अवसरको रूपमा परिणत गरेर यसलाई जोस राम्रो गर्यौं सक्सेस गर्यौं त्यसमा नै अलि चाहिँ गर्व महसुस भइराको.
Nepal's army is in charge of managing the bodies of coronavirus victims across the nation. Till Tuesday afternoon, the pandemic had killed 1,508 people in the country and infected 233,452 since the virus was first detected in January. Health workers say the pandemic will only worsen as winter sets in and limited health infrastructure, including critical care beds, is stretched.
A bridge for animals may sound little abnormal, but Forest Department of India's Northern Uttarakhand state has built a first-of-its-kind eco-bridge across a busy highway so that reptiles trying to cross over are not crushed under traffic. The 90-foot-long structure is made of bamboo, jute and grass.
The Forest Department in India's Northern Uttarakhand state has built a one-of-a-kind eco-bridge in its Ramgarh Forest Division of Nainital District for animals crossing the busy jungle road. The bridge is made of bamboo, jute and grass and is 90 feet in length. Built across the two-lane Kala Dungi Nainital Highway, it took contractors 10 days to finish the structure, which is 5 foot wide and stands 40 feet above the ground.
और इसका उद्देश्य ये है कि जो रोड एक्सीडेंट में रेप्टाइल यानी कि सरीसृप जीवों की मृत्यु हो जाती थी उसकी दुर्घटना को कम करने के लिए ये बनाया गया है. इसमें हमारा प्रयास है कि इससे जितने भी रेप्टाइल्स हैं जैसे स्नेक्स, पाइथन, लिजर्ड, मॉनिटर लिजर्ड, ये सब स्क्विरल्स लोग हैं, एंट ईटर है, ये सब इसको क्रॉस करें और रोड एक्सीडेंट से बच जाएं.
The highway is main route to Nainital and is used by a large number of vehicles, especially in the tourist season.
Animals including monkeys are many times hit by vehicles moving on the road.
Well, that's all we have for you from South Asia this evening. Now our viewers can watch the show on southasianewsline.com. You can also visit us on facebook.com/isasianewsline and follow us on Twitter at isasianewsline. That's all in tonight's edition. We will see you same time tomorrow. Good night.
Subscribe Tag TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.